From Carolla One Studios in Glendale, California, this is the Adam Carolla Show. Adam's guest today, Brett Favre, Eric Bolling, and sports broadcaster Gerry Callahan. With Gina Grad on news and Bald Bryan on sound effects, and now, between the carpentry and the masturbation, his nickname should have been Palm Nailer. Adam Carolla.
Yeah, get it on. Got to get it on. No choice but to get it on. Man, did you get it on? Thanks for tuning in, and thanks for sharing with a friend. We love that about you, right, Gina Grad?
That's right.
Handball, Brian.
Can I just have one of your ribs, and I'll smoke it and eat it, and you don't really need that rib.
Clean drop. All right. Well, I had a bunch of stuff to get into, but I just got this notice that Uppity had made a list. I don't know what the title of the list was, Maxipata, but it was, 20 African-American features, so on and so forth.
Well, it's Black History Month, that's right.
Right. Yeah. So it had made a list. It's made a few lists on it's made a few lists like on Netflix for Black Lives Matter list, and it's made a few of those kinds of lists. It wasn't surprising that 16 Black History movies to watch right now. It wasn't that it had made the list. It's where the list emanated from, which is Good Housekeeping. Good Housekeeping.
Diversifying.
Yes, who's been around since 1885. And I thought, well, that's funny to make a list on Good Housekeeping. But then I started also thinking, wow, I'll bet Good Housekeeping has changed a fair bit from initial run in 1885 to the Black History Woke List in 2021. And so I said to Maxipata, why don't you find a few covers, a few titles on Good Housekeeping?
Housekeeping is probably for the Black Help in 1885.
Yes, that's right.
How to keep... probably made for them.
Yes. Yeah. Spare the Rod. How to keep your Black Help in line without going for a switch. But I thought, it would be comical just like looking back on some of those commercials from the 70s. It was like Harold never wanted a second cup of my coffee, and how she was going into a tailspin because her husband didn't want a second cup.
Or the white glove or something.
The mother-in-law would always show up with the white glove. She'd show up, she'd put the white glove on, and then she'd reach into her purse and pull out end dust. And it's like start spraying the housewife in the face. And the housewife would go into a shame spiral because she was never good enough for that woman's son. That was really...
The dust was a referendum on her poor job as a woman.
She didn't keep a good house. So, Gina, if you have some of the years and some of the titles from Good Housekeeping, I think we can all see how much we've changed as a nation.
Yeah, I'm kind of just eyeballing this as we go, but it seems that it's going in order of food and then primping and physical appearance. So I'll just kind of pull some out. This is the food prep. This is how it starts. I'll give you a couple. Certain foods just can't miss with men. One of these is sure to be a steak. Expensive? Try a low-cost option, but make sure that you pick one that leaves him plenty to eat. Of course, he'll want to preside over this sumptuous steak. See to it that he has good, sharp knives to do his slicing.
Oh, yeah.
And plenty of elbow room.
Woman.
Yeah, leave the room, bitch.
that comes into play.
Get your sharpening wheel out, your cutting oil.
Your flint.
Drop off my steak and then clear out.
To your point, after you prepare the food ahead of time, your only other pre-dinner duty, discreetly disappear.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah. Under the folding tray, baby. That's where you should be disappearing.
Out of sight.
I cooked up some...
Under the TV tray.
I cooked up some meat for you, too.
That's right. Everybody gets something at dinner. If your intuition tells you he's weary, and it will, the minute he steps in the door, let dinner wait till he's had a few minutes to rest. Gather... Yes.
Yeah, no, I just... I had no idea where we would be going with this, but it's so detailed and nuanced about giving your man, everyone's got to keep that man happy, man. He's the earner.
I'm just going to keep going until you tell me to stop, which is probably something they would not recommend in 1965. Gather everything you need for after-dinner coffee together on a tray. With everything close at hand, you'll have no excuse to be jumping up and down.
Oh, yeah.
Jumping.
I don't know, Brian, if you're like me, but when the old lady gets up to get you some more creamer at 7:30,
That's what I was laughing at, was the idea that, like, getting up to get something you forgot to enhance the experience is like, oh, the jumping up and down constantly.
What I'm seeing from this is I didn't realize how fucking fragile men were, because this is, no, don't upset him. Don't freak him out. This whole thing is this.
I know.
A lot of the charm of this gesture will be lost if you haven't learned or don't take the trouble to make a good cup of coffee. Use careful measuring and a spanking clean pot.
Oh, yeah. You got to rinse that pot out. You got to clean it with salt, I think, and then make me some coffee.
Or else it might taste like coffee.
Now, here's Brian's section. This is where Christy needs to get her notepad out.
Here we go.
The drink beside the exotic meal should look and be a worldly one, but it needs to be uncomplicated to concoct. Try meals that have the spirit of adventure, but not food, but use foods that are basic and familiar.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. How do we pull that off?
Max Zapata has one from 1956.
Yeah, this one is The Good Wife's Guide to Helping Her Husband Succeed at Work.
Oh, yeah.
Tomorrow, your husband gets his big break. He's going to be interviewed for a key position that will be the turning point in his career, if he gets the job. To be sure, the decision will be based primarily on your husband's personality and qualifications, but more and more these days, the decision also hinges on what the boss-to-be thinks of you.
Oh, yeah. Larry Tate's coming over. He's got a big client from overseas. They're going to make their decision.
That's right.
Based on how you keep your house and how the meal is.
Yep.
That's going to dictate the trade agreement with the new firm.
Right.
Chris.
By the way, does that exist? Like where someone goes, look, we like all the numbers you put forward. We like your experience. We like your integrity of your company. But your wife's meatloaf was a little dry.
A little dry. Couldn't use more ketchup.
We're going to have to go with a lesser firm now.
I think if recent history has taught us anything, it's that big business will overlook many foibles, criminal foibles with certain people.
It goes on to say, if a man has a peevish, nagging wife, if she's jealous and possessive, if she is lazy or overambitious or extravagant, that man is going to be unhappy. And his unhappiness will interfere with his concentration on his job.
Lazy or overambitious. There's a sweet spot, ladies.
Yes. Somewhere, we should all reside somewhere between lazy and overambitious, but we should hedge a little closer to overly ambitious than the lethargy. Right, because you put him in a bad mood. Like, let's just say he's cutting his steak and his elbow catches your rib because you can't fucking let this
meal ruined.
You can't let this racehorse win. Yeah. He's going to go into work with a foul mood. I hope you've pressed his suits and gotten his ring around his collar out as well.
Before we leave the subject of how the wife can help at dinner, let me just wedge this in. To be prepared for all meal problems that could arise, a wife really has to keep on her toes and keep her wits about her. So that goes for the boss's dinner. And then just two more. Men like their wives to be pretty. Hardly ever mind all our beauty products and primping as long as the result looks natural. And finally, let men be the masters of exaggeration, like fish stories and golf. Shy away from overdone stark hairdos. Keep yours bouncy and soft. He'll rumple it more often.
Oh, yeah. Again, when he's trying to get some oral, he'll reach for that bouffant and use it like a handle. Wow. This is a mainstream publication.
Needs to be a recurring bit on this show. We need to hear more of these.
There's 100 of them.
That's outstanding.
Do you have the one from 65 about pleasing the man?
That's what Gina's been reading.
Oh, yeah. Was there one in the bedroom? They talk about what to do in the bedroom. Oh, this is just pleasing your man.
Yeah,
but
how to please your man.
Not in a sexual way, per
se. That's pretty risque for 65. I don't think.
Yeah, I think it'll start to morph into ways to please your man in the bedroom.
Wait a second. I just randomly looked at one. And Adam, here's one you could get behind. If he always seems to get in an ice jam at parties, give him several ejector trays and an ice storage caddy. Immediately update the ice department of any refrigerator.
Oh, literally, an ice, like literally yes. ice tips.
An ice jam at a party.
At parties? Now, yes. is this at your home or do I travel to other people's homes with a bucket of ice?
That's a good
with a tray of ice, apparently hanging the ice out.
I've said it once. I will say it again. The most fantastical, unbelievable part of Bewitched wasn't Sabrina, you know, shaking her nose and summoning Genghis Khan. It was when Darren would come home at 6 o'clock, he'd walk right for the bar, open the lid of the ice bucket. The ice bucket was brimming with ice.
Teeming.
And he'd just grab a few with the tongs and make himself a highball and then yell at Sam, where's dinner?
Right.
Good old days.
Could you imagine that pitch, Bryan? Like, hey, listen, Christy, I like ice. Okay. And with all the Zoom meetings and everything, yeah. it seems like you got plenty of time around the house.
I was going to say, this is going over really well now that we're 5 feet away and I can hear her all day yelling at people.
Now, I'm not coming home from work because I don't have a traditional gig, that's but right. I still like a highball. And yeah. I don't want to have to go to the fridge and wrestle with the ice tray every time.
When I'm done making 2.5 jokes on this hour and a half long podcast that we do, yeah. I'm pretty wiped out and I could really use some fresh ice.
I like that you rounded up to 2.5.
Yeah. That's funny.
Well, I think there's one good show a week where I got 3.
No, we had one goddamn, there was one ice tray. Refrigerators didn't make ice. You know, there was no ice maker. So we had one ice tray from 1944 to 1987, and
it was
the aluminum one with the handle that would freeze on it that had like the Venetian blinds as the dividers.
Ours were the twisty plastic.
Right.
I didn't know they made aluminum ones.
Oh my God. Literally from the 40s to the early 80s, they had these aluminum trays. They had a handle. The trays had dividers in them, and when you pulled the handle, it would move the dividers in such a way. But your skin would come off grabbing stupid handle because it was in the freezer. That's what she's referring to. I think she's saying you don't want
the
him
ejector.
You don't want him wrestling with that contraption. It was as if somebody created the world's worst invention for making ice cubes, and then someone said, I know, but we have to stay with it for 47 years. There shall be no alternative.
How can this thing be more dangerous? I know, freeze it.
Well, freeze it, yeah. Wow. It would never work right. The cubes, you guys never remember old school.
I've never seen this.
That is.
I was born in 78, man. Everything is plastic.
That is literally the only modality for making ice cubes it was like a week after someone invented the electric freezer to the early 80s. That was it.
I would rather drink a warm tab than wrestle with this thing.
Yeah, the plastic ones didn't really get into like the mainstream until like the 80s. And it was like, of course, just pour it into the plastic thing and twist it and it'll pop off. All right.
I'm sorry. Yes, can I please read you the last one? Because it's the best one. There's more, but this is the best one. Having to watch a woman clean the house can make a man uncomfortable, as uncomfortable as seeing her in her rollers and face cream. Mm. Try to schedule your chores so as many as possible are done when he's not around to be a captive audience.
Oh, man. You know when the old lady's pushing the vacuum cleaner and you're trying to eat your steak and you got to move your feet?
Lift your elbow.
Ugh. Jesus Christ. All right.
Humanity.
The great... Brett Favre is on along with Eric Bolling as well. They do a podcast called Bowling with Favre. Get it? It's available now on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and Podcast One as well. Good to see you guys.
Hey, man.
Hey, man. Eric, you're in your automobile?
I am, but I'm not driving, so have no fear. And we're all good, brother.
Brett, good to see you.
Can you hear me?
Perfect. Yes, we can hear you well. I saw you last night on Tucker Carlson dissecting the world of cheese. Yes.
Noted cheese expert, Brett Favre.
I got to say, I was a little disappointed that you had goat cheese on your top three of cheeses. I thought for sure he's a Havarti guy. But no,
I don't even know what that is.
I can't believe Green Bay was a goat cheese city, was it?
I don't think so. In fact, after I did the Tucker deal, I came in the kitchen and my wife, she's like, "You don't know anything about cheese."
It's true. Exactly what I said too. His number one cheese was cream cheese, everybody.
Yeah. I love cream cheese. I mean, it's a cheese, right?
That's true. He's got you there, Adam.
Technically, it's in the name.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, there's something called toe cheese that you get if you don't change your socks. I don't know if that's technically a cheese, but.
Or what about Fromunda?
Oh, that's nice.
If you drop, if you dropped that above the all-time great appearances on television.
I believe me, it crossed my mind, but I chose not to at the last second.
Probably smart.
So, well, I guess Brett and Gerry, oh, sorry. And Eric, we should be asking about the Super Bowl coming up. Thoughts? I mean, you probably definitely played with Brady, not with Mahomes, right? But
right. I never played against Patrick, but I did play against Brady. And a great storyline, along with the fact that, you know, it's a new team for Tom, but same old. It's same old Tom Brady. You know, he's back in his, now his 10th Super Bowl. If I were a bet man, which I'm not, I would want to put my money on the Chiefs, but I would never bet against Tom Brady. So it's mixed emotions.
Can I jump in? Cause we did the podcast yesterday and we had the same along the same lines, Adam, and he's so skilled at telling me why he would bet on Mahomes, but then everyone should bet on Brady. I mean, I was just like, come on, man. I got Brady plus three and I got the under 56.5, and Brett somehow figured out a way to not get cornered, you know, kind of like he's scrambling out of the pocket, rolls to his right and hits, you know, one of his receivers running down the sideline and just weaves a lot of that. I put it out there, Brett. I got Brady plus three, under 56.5. What do you think of that one?
I'm glad that's you and not me.
I think the under's a decent call because sometimes in Super Bowls, there's nerves. It's easier to play defense with nerves than it is the skilled position stuff. And those games, especially, I feel like at least the Brady, some of those Brady Super Bowls with New England, he just slowed the whole game down and ended up winning, you know, 17-14
or whatever. And you got the Buccaneer defense that calls themselves the Gravediggers, and they stepped up, you know, in the AFC Championship game, or in the NFC Championship game. And you know, I don't know, 28-28, think about that. 28-28 is 56 points. That just seems like a lot of points. Listen, what do I know?
I think the under, but I'd go with the Chiefs for the win and go with the under. That seems like a good bet.
How good Mahomes was a couple years ago, and then he just didn't show up in the Super Bowl. I know he had a big game last year, but remember that one? Remember that one?
The great ones never remember the bad games. So I was also thinking about Brett Favre. You know, Aaron Rodgers just lost, but Aaron Rodgers, one of the all-time greats, probably either going to win the MVP or did win the MVP. I can't remember.
I think they announced it Saturday.
He's going to win the MVP. That guy
should.
How long did he back you up?
3 years. Wow. 3 years. Yeah. And then we played against each other twice. If you count 2 years, we played against each other when I was with Minnesota. I saw a little bit of his evolution, in those 2 years that I was at Minnesota. We beat him the first year, both games. The second year they beat us both games. And, I knew he was well on his way to, I knew when he was backing me up, I knew that talent wise, he could do whatever he wanted. And he had a phenomenal year this year, and they were the hottest team in football until Tampa beat them. I was really shocked that Tampa was able to beat them at Lambeau. But you never know.
Brett, Brett, you've probably answered this question before, so please forgive me, but I'm curious in the more the personal, like, what's it like when you have two alpha dogs? I mean, Aaron Rodgers, he hadn't accomplished much at that point, but he was a very good prospect and a very good athlete and all that, and a highly talented college player. What's it like when you have the two alpha dogs kind of overlapping and, you know, the writing's on the wall? He's the young guy and you're the old guy. It's that, the narratives is what it is. What's it like behind the scenes for those 3 years?
Yeah, I can't speak for Aaron, but for me, it was fine. You know, he oftentimes, like, at the end of the, you know, I don't know what it's like during the pandemic, but in normal circumstances, a typical week, Wednesday and Thursday, is your long days of practice meetings. It's basically 8 to 5, 5:30. And so at around 5:30, everyone would start leaving and going home, and I would go in and watch film on my own. And I'd just kind of grab bag of film, just pick something. And he would often ask if he could tag along. And I had no problems with it. And we would sit and watch film, and you know, he'd pick my brain a little bit. Our styles are somewhat similar. Our arm strength is very similar. Mobility, he's probably a little more mobile than I was when he came in to the National Football League. But my first 5 years, and his first 5 years, would be very similar. So I saw a lot of myself in him. You know, he was like, when I went to Atlanta, when I was drafted by Atlanta, I was just turned 21. And same was the case for Aaron. So very young, considering the average age of an incoming rookie, 22 or 23. But we got along great. You know, I mean, I think he knew when they drafted him, that especially at Green Bay, that this might be a 1 to 3 year wait, barring injury. And it was. And he played a little bit, actually. A couple of times I got hurt, he came in, and he actually got hurt himself, I think. But he was put on injury reserve against the Patriots. Broke a foot or broke an arm or something, was out the rest of the year. But he certainly made his own mark, I can say that.
So a couple of questions. One is, I want to correct a statement you made. He may have been more mobile than you toward the end of your career, but now with your copper fit socks, I feel like you could run circles around that old man.
Oh, there's no question.
No question. Number one. Number two, what are his three top cheeses as a Green Bay quarterback?
I'm going to go out on a limb and say that he probably is about as much of a connoisseur of cheese as I am.
I don't know. He's a Californian. He played at Cal, right? So he probably.
Yeah, but I'm thinking he might be a little more schooled in mushrooms and you know, whatever it is these California kids grow up doing or growing.
I was thinking about, I don't want to bring up an interception from the past, but I was thinking about you when you were playing for Minnesota and you were playing New Orleans and you're in the championship game, and how damn close you got to your second Super Bowl with another organization, or third Super Bowl. Third Super Bowl with another, not many quarterbacks. I guess Peyton Manning. I'm trying to think who else. Elway? No, Elway didn't do that.
No,
that's
the question.
Now we're talking Tom Brady, but that very short list of multiple franchises and Super Bowls. And Brett was 5 yards away from winning that game, and they went on, and the Saints went on to win that Super Bowl. So, conceivably,
that's of all the plays and games and seasons that I've played in, that one haunts me the most. And of course, it's the most recent.
Well, that's why I brought it up.
But that's fine, Adam. I mean, you know, I'm a big boy. But you're right, 5 yards. And there's a lot of things that went on in that game. It was a championship game. It was in New Orleans. Winner goes to the Super Bowl. We really had them on the ropes, and we were within field goal range. We were going to run a play. I don't know if you guys would remember this.
It was 29-29, right? It was all tied up.
We were basically in field goal range, and our field goal kicker was a close friend of mine who I played with in Green Bay for many years, and then was able to play with him in Minnesota, Ryan Longwell, also a Cal guy. And so Ryan doesn't have, he's in the latter part of his career. He doesn't have a super strong leg, but we were within his range. And we somehow, we had a foo bar, if you will, where we had 12 men in the huddle. And we were penalized 5 yards.
Oh.
And I, you know, this obviously was not that long ago, but in other, it seems like it light years ago.
2010, was it?
Yeah, 2010. And we had 12 men in the huddle, and we were penalized 5 yards, which led to the next play that we had to get 5 more yards back at least.
And there was what? How much time? Just 25? 20?
Yeah, we went in overtime. So that ended the game.
Right.
Very next play, but we were going to at least have a shot at the field goal at the end. So two things, the 12 men in the huddle penalized us 5 yards, backed us up. And then that led to the interception that I threw. And yeah, in hindsight, I wish I would run it. I think, and I was hurt pretty bad, but I think I could have drugged my leg for at least 8 yards.
You know, in a way, as I was revisiting that today, and again, it's just a play that always stuck out for me. I was always a big fan of yours at quarterback, and I was rooting for you so hard because I liked this notion of going to a new team and going to the Super Bowl. And the Vikings, I guess, you know, had been a little bit snake bit in the Super Bowl world. I think probably still are, right?
Yeah, absolutely. They're over.
They're over. So I was kind of rooting for you, and I was rooting for the Vikings. And that play, in a weird way, back to Aaron Rodgers, is very reminiscent of the third down play in the championship game from a couple of weeks ago. In that,
he could have run it.
If he'd tucked it in, he probably would have got down. Maybe he would have scored. Maybe would have got to the 2-yard line. But he threw it sort of across his body.
And really should have been picked.
And tried to tuck it in. Tried to put it into a small window. And I thought, in a way, those plays were very analogous.
I thought the same exact thing. And when they showed the replay of the end zone shot and Aaron, the cameras behind Aaron, he could have walked in blindfolded. So I think the difference in that situation and my situation, we both had probably the same, you know, green grass in front of us. But that was uncharacteristic of Aaron. He wasn't banged up. He wasn't hurt. The previous week against the Rams, he actually ran one in.
Right.
Gave a little pump fake. Guy jumped. He ran it in. So it was like a week later, he's going to do the same thing. I didn't trust my legs my last 2 years like I used to. You know, I was 40 and 41 of my last 2 years. And my game, unlike Brady, was I have relied on my mobility throughout my career. You know, not as much in the latter part, but I bought time, extended plays with my legs, and my arm was great. But I tell people this, and it's true. There was times where I could feel the pressure coming, and my mental clock would say, duck. I would get drilled, and then I would try to duck. I mean, there was a little delay, which the last year, you know, when that happened like 4 or 5 times, I was like, I think it's time to hang them up. You know, when I say move, dart, move, duck, dive, get drilled, and then you try to move. You know, there's too much of a delay, and in pro football, that's not a good thing.
Bad math.
I haven't experienced that on the field, but I do understand where you're coming from, because I think I've experienced that sexually lately. Where the mind is willing, but the body is weak. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
On the other two quarterbacks to start for multiple teams in the Super Bowl, Craig Morton for the Cowboys and the Broncos.
Does that count?
And the great Kurt Warner.
Yeah.
Arizona.
Yeah, Morton was 0-2, right?
Yeah.
I think
so.
Warner was 1-1.
Right.
Definitely 1-2.
Yeah. All right. I have questions. I have more questions. I think we need to take a quick break here. Yeah. Take a quick break, and then we'll come back with Eric and Brent. We'll talk a little more ball and everything else right after this.
It's time to check Adam's voicemail.
Hey, Adam, this is Corey from Bozeman, Montana. It's negative 35 degrees, heading up the Big Sky with a load of lumber because I got to get it on every single day. Thank you for helping me keep my spirits bright.
You can leave us a message at 888-634-1744.
Eric Bolling is with us. Brett Favre is with us. Podcast Bowling with Favre. Available now on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and Podcast One as well. Here's something that I think about all the time, because you ran, you got under center a lot, but you also ran out of the shotgun a fair bit. When I see the bad shotgun snap, it drives me insane. I used to do the shotgun snap in high school, and I swear I was more consistent than half these guys in the NFL. There's nothing worse than seeing a tall, long quarterback have to pull one off his shins when it's 3rd and 7 and his move is down to the ground. You know what I mean? Versus up. How come that isn't worked on more? Like, how come the coach doesn't say after every practice, go with the backup quarterback, go with the center and do 50 shotgun snaps, and then you can hit the showers?
Some do. You know, it's one of those things that you get so used to doing it, and it doesn't bother you. When I say it doesn't bother you, I'm referring to the coach, the quarterback, the center, until it costs you the game. If that makes sense, you know, it's like, you know, jumping off sides is not a big deal. It happens, but if it costs you the game or 12 men in the huddle, then we got a problem with it. So why wait till you have a problem with it to fix it? You know, it's one of those things, and the good coaches and the good players generally fix those problems before they occur, and not wait. So, and I guess my point is the good teams, the good coaches, work on those little things. The little things that is exactly what kills you. Because a lot of times the little things are what's overlooked the most.
Did you, so this will lead me into a sort of esoteric question, not involving cheese. So I'll give you a break, but that I know as someone who's like on stage, when something is happening where I said, I don't want this thing to happen, and then it happens, I get really distracted and it kind of pulls my focus and I get a little off my game. And so when you're playing quarterback and the guy snaps it down to your shin, or you're trying to motion for someone to go into motion and you're calling an audible and the guy's supposed to go in motion and he's not going in motion, are you like up in your head going, God damn it, we worked on this. Like, why are you not doing this? And then does that affect the next play?
As I like to say, the shit hits the fan when that happens. All bets are off. It's like, what? You're scrambling around and you look like a complete idiot trying to find the ball. And, you know, it's fumbling around. Or maybe you pick the ball up, but your rhythms, I mean, there is no rhythm. You know, maybe it was a 3-step drop, maybe it was a 5-step drop, but your eyes are off of the read. The eyes are off. I mean, So to get back into, I mean, it's almost virtually impossible to read the play out, make a good throw. Now you may have a successful play, but it's not the way you draw it up.
Right. Cause you're focused on picking the ball up off your feet versus looking down the field.
Absolutely.
I have said that, when Seattle was playing the Patriots in the Super Bowl and Butler made that pick where he just closed the window, The ball was snapped a little lowish, like around it hit Russell Wilson sort of in the groin versus up top in the chest. And in that millisecond, Butler jumped the route.
You're absolutely 100% correct. I mean, when you're making a split second decision, a split second throw that close, you don't have any margin for error, none. And every little millisecond counts offensively and defensively. So if he'd have got it off of just a tick sooner, does it at least fall incomplete? Probably so.
I want to include Eric in the conversation. Eric, what are your three top cheeses?
No, this is fascinating.
This is your top three cheeses.
I happened to look down and Eric was sleeping.
I'm actually, I had a question, and I love this conversation. I mean, this is just stuff you just can't get watching any sports program. I love it. I'm wondering how many times you call, Brett, how often do you call off a coach's call? You know, last minute you see it, you see a blitz, you didn't see, or someone's creeping up on the line and you change the play. Is it 10% of the time? Is it 20% of the time?
Yeah. Okay. So I played 20 years. My first year I didn't play with Atlanta. My next six were with Mike Holmgren. And that was an era to me in itself. Yeah. You know, we won the Super Bowl. We lost the Super Bowl. Really, he kind of shaped me for the future. In other words, when he left, I found myself saying the things he said, playing the way he wanted me to play. He sort of shaped me in a good way. My 6 years with Mike Holmgren is sort of a microcosm of the rest of my career in that, my first few years with Holmgren, I would say, you know, maybe it's a TV timeout. And we're talking on within my first 3 years with him. So in his mind, you got to keep in mind, when Mike Holmgren took over as the head coach at Green Bay, he had just left San Francisco where he had been the offense coordinator for Joe Montana and Steve Young. And now he's coaching me, who was as raw as they come, you know. I didn't know a split back from an I formation, you know, but I could throw it through a damn brick wall. So when I would say to him, let's run this, he would say, he had two terms he called me. He called me Billy Bob and John Wayne. That was what he called me. And I'm being completely honest. If I was playing my ass off and playing tough and all that stuff, it was John Wayne. He's like, good job, John Wayne. If I was fumbling the ball around, making goofy decisions, drilling, bouncing them off helmets and stuff like that, I was Billy Bob. So the first 3 years I was Billy Bob. So when I would even entertain checking out of a play, he would say, no, Billy Bob, you're not there. You're not there yet. So, you know, fast forward to the Super Bowl, which is in year four, I think, with Holmgren, the first play of the game, I checked a complete different play and hit Andre Rison for what would be one, maybe the biggest touchdown in my career. I made the right check. I made the right read. And then you got to make the right throw and a perfect throw in one of the biggest settings in the world. And it's first play of the game. I mean, everything could go wrong. And in that game, I changed the play twice in the Super Bowl. And the average game offense runs 75 plays a game on average. Mm-hmm. So I would say throughout my career, if you just took the average of the 20 years, I would say 3 to 10. That's kind of and some were not so much a change of a play. It may be give a guy a different route, or it may be a run play, but instead of having your guy block to the run side, have him run a route. And if they don't cover him and they play the run, you throw it to him. And you hear now RPOs, run pass option.
One of the biggest games I think you'll be remembered for is the game, I think it was against the Raiders when your father died.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of question about whether you'd play or not. Was it a Monday night football game or Sunday?
It was.
Monday night. Monday night was the Raiders, if memory serves. Your father had passed when?
Saturday.
And so there was a lot of talk about whether you'd take the field or not because how close you were with your father. And then Brett came out and just played lights out, just a crazy lights out game. What was that experience like?
It was about as bittersweet. You're right. I don't ever brag about any game that I've ever played in. But that one, I could not play any better. And if there was a game that I wanted to play the best ever, that was it. Because there was a lot of talk, oh, will he or won't he play? I knew right away I was going to play. I had to try to compose myself as best as possible, and that in itself was hard. But playing was not the hard part, in my mind, because my dad was a high school football coach. As far back as I can remember, I stayed after school and was a ball boy, a manager, a water boy for my dad, and then at some point, I played for him, just like my older brother and my younger brother. So when we sat down at the breakfast table, we talked football. When we drove home from school, we talked football. When we sat down for supper, we talked football. So you get what I'm saying. That's who we were. So not playing was no option. But I played in two Super Bowls before this happened. And I can honestly say that I had never been nearly as nervous as I was in the Oakland game, because I wanted to honor my dad, not by playing, but by playing better than I've ever played ever. And, you know, that's a tall task, especially when your head's not in it. I mean, I knew that right after the game, my wife and I, we're flying back to Green Bay. We were getting Christmas presents at our house. Then we were flying down to Mississippi for the funeral service. And keep in mind, this happened 23rd of December. So not that there's ever a good time to lose someone, but right before Christmas. So the service, we have to go down. You do a somber Christmas service, but also you bury your father. And I wanted to do all that with my chest stuck out and proud that I honored my father. I mean, he taught me everything I know. How could I not want to play and honor him? And I was nervous, man. I'm not going to lie. I was so afraid that I was going to fail in that game and I knew that, say I did play just okay. Everyone would said, well, what the hell do you expect? I mean, he just lost his father. I mean, my goodness. And so I wanted to play better than I've ever played before. And I prayed and prayed and prayed, God, please give me, you know, all the tools I need. And at halftime, I'm like, this is unbelievable. Because at halftime, I've had the best statistical half that I've ever had in four quarters. So already at halftime, but I had basically almost 400 yards. I was 399 at halftime. I never threw for 400 yards before that in a career.
Wow.
I mean, we're talking about half. And so it was, so I say it was bittersweet. you know, and I've said this, and I said this in a lot of places to a lot of different people when I talk about this game. But so the Oakland Raiders, you know, I've been playing in that Coliseum for years, and I played there a fair amount, but you know, it was rare when we went out there and played. And the fans generally are not very, they're not very good. You can kind of get the thing. Yeah, they're not. But they gave me a standing ovation when they called out the offense, and I was the obviously the quarterback. And they called out at quarterback Brett Favre, and they gave me a standing ovation. Now, that gave me chill bumps, because what I was used to was, hey, screw you, you know. And then after the game, this brought me to tears. So my wife and I had chartered a plane. Right after the game, we had the police said, hey, we'll give you an escort to the airport, just me and my wife. And I was like, man, I can't thank you enough. So they gave me a police escort that any president would be proud of. And like when we got to an intersection, they were standing, like the cops were standing saluting. I mean, it was incredible. I get goosebumps thinking about it right now. Just a tremendous amount of respect for how they treated us on that particular night.
I was, in Monday Night Football, there's a couple of games that stand out. There's, I think, the Bo Jackson game, yeah. But this is one of them. This is a top three, top five game. Brett Favre and after his father died. I'm inspired now to do my best podcast after my dad dies. He's still alive, but I'm going to wait till he moves on before I bring my A game. The podcast. I'm sorry. Did you have something, Bryan?
I was just going to say the NFL has it ranked as the 52nd greatest game in their 100 greatest games list, and that's saying something.
Wow. I did not know that, but yeah.
I didn't know it either, actually.
Take a look at that Monday night miracle. Bowling with Favre, it's available now on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Podcast One as well. Brett Favre, Eric Bolling, thanks you guys for joining us.
Man, thanks for having us.
Yeah,
thanks for having us. Appreciate it.
We hope to be as successful as you in the podcast world.
I think you got it. I think you got enough stories to do it. Thanks, guys.
Goodbye. Bye, Adam.
Take care.
Goodbye, man. Thank you.
All right. Let's see. I got Simply Safe here. Everyone wants to keep their home and family safe from break-ins, fire, flood, medical emergencies as well. Simply Safe Home Security, award-winning 24/7 protection. Not only an arsenal of cameras and sensors, you get the best professional monitors in the business. They've got your back day and night, ready to send police, fire, EMTs as well. We've been using these guys for over a decade. They're a great company. They make a great product. Peel and stick. Batteries last up to 10 years, up and running in about 30 minutes. Then their professionals take over. They'll monitor your home 24/7, ready to send help at a moment's notice. No long-term contract, hidden fees, or installation costs either. And right now, our listeners get a free home security camera with the purchase of a Simply Safe system at simplysafe.com/Adam. There's you can try the 60-day risk-free trial. Visit simplysafe.com/Adam for your free security camera. Do it today. All right, so a couple of calls up there. Glad I remembered that story about his dad passing in that Monday night game. I did not know that he threw for more yards in the first half than he did in any of his other games in four quarters.
Yeah, it says 311 yards in the first half, 399 total. Obviously, they didn't need to do a lot of offense in that second half.
Yeah, he just played lights out, and Gina probably doesn't remember, but it was a big story. Like, is he going to play? How's he going to play? He was so close to his dad.
Of course, that makes sense. I love that he said, you know, nobody knew, but I knew. Of course I was going to play. This is what we were about.
It's always you would be honoring your dad. It's so it's the opposite. It's of course you're going to play because that's what your dad was about. Yes, sorry.
Right. Oh, most Packers fans that I know have they. If you talk, have you ever cried at a game? At a game, that's the game they always bring up.
Do you ask most sports fans?
Yeah, yeah. That's
nice to meet you. I'm Chris.
Great icebreaker
for you.
But now to be even-handed, he did say cream cheese is his favorite cheese, which is either the weakest choice ever or diabolical because it's very versatile.
It threw you off.
Yes, it threw me off. All right, let's see. We got a couple of calls. We'll talk to line one. And I do want to, at some point, circle back to good housekeeping because this is endlessly fascinating to me.
We have plans for it.
I could listen to Gina read those all day. and again, Uppity is, I don't know, number
13,
10, number 13 out of 15. Andy, 41, New Mexico.
How's it going, Adam?
Good.
Paul,
how you doing?
Gina.
Hey, yeah. Hey. Hi, guy.
Hey, thanks for all you guys do. The show just keeps getting better.
Oh, thank you. What do you got?
So before the break, you guys were talking about Pussy Rock and how they were whining and crying, but you forgot country music. In the 2010s, country music was just full of male singers singing about how every light in the house will be on, we'll never turn them off.
These are great
Griffin
songs.
Has a song.
For pussies.
Yeah, Blake Griffin has a song where he details everywhere he's going. It's called Austin. What he's going to do every day of the week, just in case she calls. and so I think country music may have rock beaten that.
Wow.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I feel like rap is the last genre to stay really true to the form, right?
Oh, sure.
They're
true to the game.
They don't do a lot of apologizing and internalizing and all that kind of stuff that's going on now, even in country music.
As long as you don't mix up rap with R&B, which is all about I swear and on bended knee, that's different. That's not rap.
Yeah. With a healthy dose of loving you up, too. That's sexual stuff. Yes, Bryan.
I was going to say our caller, Andy, might be onto something because Rascal Flatts debuted in 2000, and that is the harbinger of big pussy country rock.
Oh, really?
Oh, my God, the worst. The fucking worst. Put up a picture. Just a picture. I didn't even hear a song. You'll hear the music when you see these homos.
Go, Bryan.
The front man looks like Guy Fieri's brother. And I didn't know.
Guy Fieri's doughy brother who stopped working out.
I didn't know that the song, the God Bless the Broken Road, wasn't theirs. So I can like that song again. Because I thought it was a lovely song.
That is their song.
No, remember, you told me it was a cover.
Oh, I'm so they made it, they had a huge hit with it.
Right.
Yes, sorry.
Right.
Yes.
The let's hear a little Toby Keith, because I feel like we need a palate cleanser. And he could have written Tool Tune?
It's a bad song.
Number one Tool Tune of all time.
Get out of here, Gina. You know what you're talking about.
Oh my God.
It's a bad song. It's the best country song ever written.
I hope Dawson's throwing up in his flask.
Dawson loves this bad boy.
Please don't do this to me. Please don't do this to me.
It's all right. Dawson doesn't like it.
Toby Keith gets a lot of shit for his jingoistic songs. Yeah, put a boot in your ass and all that shit. And blah, blah.
I think country music kind of peaked in 1993, 94. I don't go any further.
Well, maybe I never was a country music fan, and when I heard this one, I'm like, now
I like it.
I like that song. I think Toby Keith has much better songs, like Should Have Been a Cowboy or.
All right. Bryan doesn't like it. Gina does.
I like it.
So it can't be considered a Tool tune. It's not good enough for a Tool tune.
No, it doesn't rise. That's a guilty pleasure. If you like that, you're allowed to like it. That's a guilty pleasure.
It's a good song. I think it's a good song.
Oh, boy.
I don't.
Wow.
Max Zapata.
Not only is it a great song, but it's also not a Tool tune because I have been in the car with Adam, windows down, volume blaring.
Well, I was drunk.
Oh, no.
Were we driving home from a race or something?
Yeah.
Well, I have a few beers in the car, and I'm blowing off steam, you know, from the race. All right.
Where did you even hear that song? I've never heard that before. Is that a hit?
Yeah, I think it was a hit. It was a hit.
I've never heard it.
It was number one, actually, on country charts.
It was weird because I think, if I can recall, I would never listen to the country station, especially in L.A. We didn't have a lot in the way of country, I guess, but there probably was one. And I was driving to Loveline one night, and I got in the car, and I was heading down the hill, and I think it was back when I was just kind of scanning through the radio, what you would do in your car, you know, just hit the scan button and the seek button and see what the next song. And it was probably just going through the country station because I didn't have the country station on the presets. And I think it just stopped here. And it must have been during the part where he was yodeling or something.
And Jesus Christ.
I was probably like, what is this? Because it didn't feel like, it didn't sound like a country song to me. And then I probably just listened to it or the rest of it on the way into Loveline and then had it in my head.
Lest our listeners think that I'm just some left coast elite who hates country music.
Oh, no, far from it.
Dawson and Gina will testify. Yeah. We often reminisce about the good old days of country music, and we go deep.
Yeah.
I love country music. Toby Keith sucks, and this song sucks.
Oh, you don't like anything Toby Keith does.
He has a couple of good songs. Dawson's right. Should Have Been a Cowboy is a good song. There's a couple peppered in there.
In contrast to that, I was doing the dishes over the weekend. We had a sink full. We don't have a dishwasher. Windows open. Speaker blaring, let's give them something to talk about. Bonnie Raitt, I probably listened to that five times. I hope you don't consider that a Tool tune, Bryan, even though it was effed out.
No, it's a great song.
But I think that's going to be my new karaoke song because you know they have it. It's a great song. Everybody loves it. She's amazing.
Which one? Give them something to talk about?
Yeah. Let's give them something to talk about.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, good song. Yeah, it's a good song.
She's the best.
All right. Gerry Callahan, radio show host, sports reporter. We'll take a quick break and talk to Gerry right after this.
Adam Carolla's I'm Your Emotional Support Animal, navigating our all woke, no joke culture, has over 1,000 five-star reviews on Amazon. Here's one.
Quick, hilarious read. As in his podcast, he writes the candor, common sense, and humor on you during this time. Freedom and total DSP are crucial community and should be fought. And any cause you ask political correctness need to obliterate. I say Carolla for president.
Couldn't have said it better myself. Pick up I'm Your Emotional Support Animal, navigating our all woke, no joke culture. And leave your five-star review on Amazon. Get all the links at adamcarolla.com.
Gerry Callahan, a legendary sports reporter and radio guy from way back, wrote for the Sun in Lowell, Massachusetts. Our own Mike Lynch hails from Lowell, or at least he's there now. Mm-hmm. And Sports Illustrated for a number of years. Also did terrestrial radio, hosted a long time morning radio for 22 years, and now a podcast, the Gerry Callahan Podcast, available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and Podcast One as well. Good to see you, Gerry.
Thanks, Adam. Good to see you.
22 years of morning?
Yes, we only had Adam Carolla on one time. I'm sure you remember it well. I'm sure it's one of your fondest memories. You were...
You won't stop talking about it.
I think you were humping not Taco Bell material. And I have to confess, I loved it. It was one of my favorite books. I kissed your ass up and down. You just, you know, you were going through like probably 100 interviews that day, pushing the book and didn't have, you know, I'm sure it wasn't one of your fondest memories, but we had a good time.
I remember it well. Oh, I remember circling it on my, out of the 28 interviews I had to do from 4 a.m. to 8:30 in the morning that day. So what is the state? I guess, Gina, I mean, we're all kind of qualified to answer this. What's going on with terrestrial radio? As someone's, collectively, we've been in it for 50 years.
From my view, it's dying, and it's dying fast, and I will tell you why, because everybody is playing scared now. The power of social media. And you know, I think terrestrial radio was one of the first targets of cancel culture. You said something, and I'm sure you did it once or twice, said something that somebody didn't like. It was so much easier to make your life miserable. They could email, They could get up a group and come after you. In the old days, they had to write a letter, and you know, it took a little effort. Now
I just had this conversation last night about how easy it was, how like the FCC would get complaints, written letter complaints about, oh, Howard Stern said this, or whoever, fill in the blank, said this, please investigate.
We were talking about death threats on my show the other day, and they used to be real. You know, you get a letter saying, I know where you live, I know what, you know where you park, I'm coming to get you. And you'd turn the letter over to management, and they'd give it to the cops. And I had that a couple of times. Now people say, oh, you got death threats. You know, AOC got death threats.
Right.
That just means some idiot tweeted, I want to see you dead. It's not a real death threat. They don't.
Listen, if your heart's beating, it's not a death threat. You got to wait till I was thinking back of getting thrown off of our Hawaiian affiliate when I was doing Loveline a million years ago. I literally lost an entire island because I said Hawaiians were dumb. And somebody started arguing with me, and I said, think of all the great Hawaiian inventors throughout the past. And we got pulled off. I remember that. And by the way, you don't want to get thrown off of Hawaii. You want an affiliate in Maui because you want to do the, I'm coming out there and I'm going to do a live show, you know?
Well, it's a long story and I'm sure you don't want to hear it all, but the reason I got thrown off is I said a four-year-old child is too young to transition. It was a story in the Boston Globe and they were celebrating this child who was four and I think was transitioning from a boy to a girl. And I said, that's ridiculous and outrageous and the kid's too young. And then this mob led by one guy, a transgender activist, came after me, came after the station, me and my show, and he was relentless and he just didn't stop. And for 2 years, and they finally gave up and waved the white flag, made a deal with him. And if I went away, he would go away. And that's the God's honest truth. And
the great,
you know, they made me go to sensitivity training. They made me, you know, they made us meet with them and put do a podcast on the subject and literally do everything he asked, and it wasn't enough. They eventually got my partner went first, and then I went, and I guess he went away. I don't know.
Transgender activists have a lot of free time, I found, and they will make you miserable. Mario Lopez got busted for basically saying the same thing, several years ago. He had to, like, walk that back. I mean, we're really at a place now where you ask guys, what about a four-year-old transitioning? And you go, I think it's too young, or I would not advise my daughter to blah, blah, blah. And you got to walk that shit back? Jesus fucking Christ. And by the way, the thing that's nuts about it is, do you think the lion's share of Americans agree with the transgender activist asshole? You think they agree with that idiot? That's the insane thing. The minority has hijacked the majority here. That's the insane part of this whole thing.
And it's on today. It's a huge deal. As you know, Michael Che made a joke Saturday night during the Weekend Update. And I saw it and I didn't think anything of it. And now 2 days later, it's, you know, TMZ. Michael Che is under fire from transgender activists because he made some dumb joke, and I can't remember it. It wasn't particularly offensive. I met with the guy, and he admitted four was a little too young to transition.
I'd say most Americans would agree with that thought.
He didn't care. He just didn't think we handled it with enough sensitivity, and he wasn't going to stop until he brought us down. And today, you know what I do, Adam, and I'm sure you do too. I'm glad they got rid of me 2 years ago or a year and a half ago, because since then, there would have been 100 different days where they would have fired me, you know, because just today, there are any topic you discuss, whether it's, you know, lockdowns, whether it's.
I'll tell you the problem. The problem really is I see it with Dr. Drew. I see how stifled he is. So when some subject like race comes up or transgender or whatever, all of a sudden he just zips it. That's what you're. So you have people who are essentially social commentators, the radio show hosts and podcasters and whatever, and comedians, hosts of Anchor Desk at Saturday Night Live, the news. we want these people to share their opinions. Now, we don't have to agree with their opinions, but we'd like them to freely share their opinions. All the people we grew up watching, you know, your Richard Pryors and your George Carlins, you thought, well, that's his opinion. All varied, all different, life experiences different, but we got their unvarnished opinion. People are just getting shut down now. Like people are going to stay. And I've seen it. I've done plenty of interviews and been interviewed where I like brought up race or brought up some subject and just watched the anchor just, I don't know about that.
Okay.
Like, all right, great, everyone. We'll cancel the fucking dialogue, you asshole hypocrites who constantly talking about having a dialogue and an honest dialogue. Your version of honest dialogue is everyone agree with your ass. Otherwise, you're fucking out.
It's just
fuck
the opposite.
You.
And you wrote about it, and I'll give you credit. But Adam, you're big enough to get away with. There's a lot of people who aren't, and they might be on terrestrial radio. You know, they might be young guys podcasting, and they can't tell the truth. They can't speak from the heart. What do you think? You mentioned whatever.
Well, I want to just jump in for 1 second. It's not even that they can't say the truth. It may not be true. It's their opinion. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know what is true and what is definitively false, especially when you take something, a nebulous subject like transgender or Black Lives Matter. Like, they're so nuanced. There's so much going on. There's so many moving parts. But the insidious part is they're not allowed to share their opinion.
Right. And I see it too. And they stifle, they curl up in a ball and they say, I better, you know, in sports radio now, if the subject turns to Colin Kaepernick, they panic.
We
got to move on and talk about the Celtics backcourt and who should be coming off the bench or whatever. Some ball. They can't do it because they're afraid. And I understand why. Their job is on the line if they piss off the wrong person. It's so easy to scare up a mob and come after you now that for self-preservation, people won't touch certain subjects. And you know what? Those are the subjects everyone's talking about on their podcast or in their private lives. They're talking about BLM and riots and lockdowns and the election. What do you think? You mentioned Richard Pryor or George Carlin. When Stephen Colbert was crying on inauguration night, what were his predecessors? And I'm not talking about Johnny Carson. I'm talking about, you know, Carlin or Pryor. What would they think if they saw that today? That an alleged late night comic was in tears because his candidate was getting inaugurated. It just seems like we've lost our way.
Those guys used to smoke. Johnny Carson would be smoking and taking a belt of vermouth, you know, during commercial breaks. I mean, obviously a different time. Do you have Michael Che's indiscretion or whatever it was?
Oh, you have it. Great.
President Biden signed an executive order repealing Trump's ban on transgender people serving in the military. Fortunately, yeah, it's good news. It's good news, except Biden is calling the policy don't ask, don't tuck, which is not good news.
Oh, please.
It's a decent joke.
Yeah, the scary part. Yes, the context. There's a context. Yes, go ahead.
There's the context. Let me give you, this is from Decider. I'm just reading you the first part of the paragraph. Viewers at home, however, didn't think the joke was so quote unquote whatever, because Michael Che was like, it's whatever. And they came on Twitter to say so. This is from a trans activist named Plastic Martyr. I'm tired of our genitalia and our existence being discussed, obsessed about, and laughed at. Wasn't surprised at all to learn that Michael Che used the lifting of the transgender military ban to be his usual transphobic self.
Oh, that's
he typically transphobic?
Oh, famously.
He got in trouble a year ago. He did something similar. That's why he was looking at Colin Jost and, you know, saying, uh-oh, because he knew he stepped in it. Even though it wasn't particularly funny or edgy, just the fact that he did it was controversial. You aren't allowed to joke about that. You know that. You're not allowed to make transgender jokes, even if they're funny.
We're allowed to say whatever the fuck we want, everybody.
You are.
All right, I am. And if everyone else would start doing that, then none of this would work. It'd have no effect. It's essentially invisible. It's not like these people wield any power. It's not like they have weapons. It's not like they have anything. All they have is their fucking horrible disposition, and we should ignore it. and move forward. And I don't, now you know Michael Che has to vet all of his jokes, even if it's just in his head, right? Do we want our late night SNL news anchors vetting all their jokes with how it's going to affect this community or that community? And at the end of the day, then, and here's the other thing too, and I always say this about people, you know, the worst thing you can do, like as an employee or as a student or as anything, is just to have the boss go, I didn't want to talk about that guy. Get him, I don't even see that guy. Like, nah, I'm not going to bring it up. I'm not going to bring that guy. Like, you will. So then every single joke will just be about Trump or Biden or whatever white heterosexual male like that. You will no longer be in the conversation or in the lexicon of people we can make jokes about, and you will exile yourself. You're a spokesperson for the trans community, but the trans community shall not be uttered on the set of Saturday Night Live anymore. Nice job, spokesperson. Anything else you'd like to be the spokesperson of, you fucking retard? So they will never bring your name up everywhere? Jesus Christ. Well, what if you were the spokesperson for Tide, and then the job was no one will ever bring up Tide ever again on TV? Oh, job well done.
One thing. Yes. They were on the first time, I think it was a month and a half since SNL was on. And since then, a few things have happened in the country. I don't know if you've noticed. They did an hour and a half without making a Biden joke or a Kamala Harris joke. So, I mean, obviously that we know they're political, but you'd think SNL would feel an obligation to, I don't know, poke fun at the new president at some level. I mean, it's not like there's anything to make fun of, or, you know, wouldn't want to have a Hunter Biden character or Kamala Harris. They have a good Kamala Harris, Maya Rudolph, but they didn't do it. They stayed away from mocking the president.
I know. And the problem was a couple things. I think Jim Carrey said he wasn't going to do Biden.
They have their own cast member. I can't remember who it is, but they've transitioned.
Who
back
does
to
Biden? But you have to do some Biden and some Kamala Harris stuff, because otherwise you're going to show your prejudice. That, and we don't want that. I want to just watch and assume that whoever's in office is going to get equally made fun of.
This is the affirmative action that I assume we all hate. Like, I don't want an equal number of jokes on the boring guy and the outrageous guy who was just doing crazy shit for 4 years. I want the funniest material. What in the last... Okay, so Biden was president for 10 days before that SNL aired. What in those 10 days... Also, I'll put it up to the floor. Is worth making fun of. What? Give me a joke.
I'll give you one.
Yeah, please.
There was a little button on the desk where Trump used to press for the guy to bring Coke.
Yep. Oh, the button. Yeah, yeah.
Could we pretend that maybe Hunter thought it was, oh, if I hit this button, they'll bring me some Coke? No?
No, but...
That's pretty good.
No. Bryan, you are doing a reverse engineering on this, which is incorrect.
That's not better than Tucker.
It's not what has he said. It's he is the new president. You guys are SNL. You make fun of whoever's in that position.
They used to make fun of Gerald Ford for being clumsy and falling down the stairs.
But exactly, there was something. There was something to make fun of. I don't doubt there will be something. I hope there's something in the future, but in the 10 days he was president, but he's just a fucking
You can go back to before he was president.
All right.
But Bryan, in your thought process, is he has to have done a Dick Van Dyke like pratfall on a coffee table?
Yes, there has to be some material to
there's,
go.
Well, there's things they could.
He loses
could,
his way.
To
sometimes.
Be fair,
if they wanted
exactly.
to, if they wanted to, they would do something.
He's the one that pivoted out of nowhere to bring up Corn Pop was a bad dude, and I have long leg hair, and the lifeguards would stare at it. So I mean, he has things that are already a caricature of him, and hopefully they'll bring that to attention. My hope is my favorite thing in the history of Weekend Update is the Christmas present that Colin Jost and Michael Che give to each other, which is they do each other's material, but they're always like, Colin will put in something horrible and Michael's will be so racist for Colin to read. And it is hysterical. That is going to go by the wayside. And that is irreverent and hilarious and things that they know the other can't say, which is why they put it in their bit for the other person. That's going to be over.
Yeah, it's not when it bleeds, when it gets into the comedians, people, that's bad. It's bad. You don't want to live in that society. It's comedians should not be up in their head about what they're going to say next and how it's going to affect, you know, this community or that community. Let me give you a plug here, Gerry Callahan, the Gerry Callahan podcast. It's available now on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and Podcast One. And the website, the Gerry, with a G, by the way, GerryCallahanPodcast.com. Gerry, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me, Adam. I appreciate it. And thanks for to the whole crew. It was fun.
We will take a quick break. We'll come back and do the news right after this.
Give me the news with Grad. News with Gino Grad. Breaking viral. Weird crime, protest, politics. Give me news with Gina Grad. Stuff they saw on TMZ. Joe Biden. Kamala. Big news with Gina. Gina Grad.
The news with Gina Grad.
So big Bezos news, at least for him. We don't know why, but maybe that'll come out. Jeff Bezos is letting go of his creation. He's stepping down as CEO of Amazon this fall. He started the company in 94 as an online bookseller, which most people don't remember. But as sales and profits grew, he expanded the business. Of course, today, Amazon sells everything.
I'm kind of picturing like where it started was obviously you buy a book and now it's you buy your air fryer on Amazon
groceries.
And groceries and prescription drugs and dildos.
Watch movies on it. Yep.
Right. I envision a day not too far from now where you turn on Amazon and there's a picture of you and it just says for sale. And you're like, what? What is this? No, we're fucking selling everything.
Oh, prime shipping. Might as well get two.
Yeah. My kids are on there as well. Nana, what are you? She's not even alive. Like, what can't they sell on there?
Yeah.
They're going to. Are they into cars? Will they get into cars? There's going to be an Amazon smart car or something.
You can buy car parts, of course, you know, for almost any car part.
Right, but they're just going to
keep
going.
I bet you can't
going.
Buy human organs.
Well, that day is coming soon. So
that's coming soon.
He stepped down or over.
He's going to step down. The company is worth $1.6 trillion.
Trillion. Can I say this?
Jesus.
Bezos, the guy's like fit. You know what I mean? Like he wears his shirts, he tucks them in tight. He's got, you know, 14% body fat or something.
Thin guy for sure, yeah.
Yeah, but it's not, he looks fit. You know what I mean? Okay. Like he looks like to be in good shape. He doesn't seem to be spindly. He looks, I don't know what he does, but I'm thinking about all these guys now, you know, over to Facebook or Google or Bezos or whatever. Remember the fat cats? Remember the guys, the railroad barons, the big fat guys like smoking
portly
cigars, you know what I mean? The brandy snifter. Yeah. Where are those guys? These guys, you take, if you took the Bezos or the Bezos of the world and what's his name that runs Twitter?
Elon Musk and Steve Jobs and Zuckerberg.
Dorsey.
And Dorsey's doing push-ups somewhere now over some plat of like macrobiotic, you know, something with the cold plunge and the ultra marathon. Like what happened to the fat cat? You know, guy was,
miss the fat
he was like so fat he could barely get his pocket watch out of his vest because of pressure was pushing. So his gut was pushing against a pocket watch, you know, to pull the pocket watch out.
So what you're saying is Chris Christie is a vestige of the past.
Well, Chris Christie's not running, a major tech company
he's running.
And is he even that rich?
He is. That's what I'm saying. No, he's a politician. I'm saying I want that guy, the billionaire club. Yeah. Like those guys were fat. They would show those guys, except for Henry Ford. Fucked up my joke royally, that spindly ass. But I'm saying, like, these guys just don't look like if you saw Bezos, I would challenge us to reanimate, Carnegie or, Rockefeller, all these guys, these oil barons and railroad barons and stuff, and show them Jeff Bezos. Like, they'd be like, I don't know what this fucking bald kid guy
does.
That's
your master.
Yes. He seems sickly.
Yes.
I'm glancing at the list of this computer's slow, but I'm glancing at the list of like the Forbes billionaire list. I think Steve Ballmer is the closest we're going to get to that on that list. And he's not even that fat. Like he owns the Clippers, the Microsoft guy. He's the bald guy you always see cheering for the Clippers or whatever. He's soft. He's softed kind of, but I wouldn't call him fat.
Yeah, find a picture, Chris, of Bezos. Like, I've seen, like, pictures of that guy like, getting onto a jet ski or something. Like, he's in good shape. So I think what's going on is back in the day when you were super rich, that just meant more food, more booze, and more whores for me. Yes. And I'm not going to...
More cigars.
I'm not mowing any lawns, and I'm not running on... I'm not going on any hikes. I'm a fucking rich person. I'm not doing any of that shit. Now... Today's rich guy goes the other direction, which is I have access to my cold dunk tank and my hyperbaric chamber and my like I have all this stuff at my disposal and I want to live forever.
Yeah.
I mean, you think
literally
being worth several billion dollars and then you find out, you got cancer and you're going to die. Oh, this is him on a jet ski.
Wow.
He's in fucking good shape, this guy.
I've only ever seen him in a suit. I didn't realize he had fucking guns.
I'll see him in like the dress shirt tucked in nice and tight every once in a while. And I'm like, this guy's in fucking phenomenal shape. Yeah.
Because, no fat guys on this list.
No, because they figured it out. But I really think it's more about a narcissistic desire to live to 125 years old because, once you've made your first $1 billion, getting a cooler car is not really going to cut it because you could buy yourself a Bugatti, but a guy with $500 million could buy himself a Bugatti. Like, what is what's the real game changer when you have billions of dollars? And that is living till 125.
Yeah, licking death.
Right.
That's a good point. When you said, what don't they sell on Amazon? My first thought was caskets.
Oh,
so
I went
to Amazon, caskets for humans, because there's different categories. The average one is about $1,300. They'll deliver it right to your house. I don't think you can get it prime. So for the Jews, because we hurry things along, you're going to want to plan ahead. But in general, you can go ahead and get your casket there. A little bit more sort of Google the ladies right when it comes to Marilyn Manson. Adult film star Jenna Jameson has commented on his idiosyncrasies, I guess, in an interview with the Daily Mail.
Eccentricities?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. She had a fling with him in 97, and she said she put the brakes on things because it was getting too weird. This is her quote. We didn't go out long because I cut it off after he would nonchalantly say he fantasized about burning me alive. Once he started speaking to me violently, I was like, goodbye, Brian. Also, the bruises from him biting me weren't fun. Sexually, he liked to bite, and it was disconcerting. From Jenna Jameson.
Yeah. So when you offend Jenna Jameson in the bedroom, that means you're probably well beyond the pale for most of the ladies.
You've overstepped.
Yeah, Minnesota mom.
Oh, yeah.
You heard of Marilyn Manson?
Well, I heard of Marilyn Monroe. Are they, is that her sister? I was told at the scrapbooking party last Christmas, I do a great Marilyn Monroe. Do you want to hear it?
I guess we have to now.
A kiss on the cheek might be quite continental, but diamonds are a girl's best friend.
Oh, that's good.
I just like her.
It's a he. The
oh.
Yeah.
Meryl Manson.
No, okay. No, you're thinking of Meryl Stubing, the captain from the Love Boat. This is Marilyn Manson. It's a fella. Mm. It's a fella. Have you been keeping up on your good housekeeping issues?
I wouldn't miss one. In fact, one did go missing, and I tore the house up and down looking for it. And I said to myself, well, that's not very good housekeeping.
Yeah. Yeah. I kind of call those the salad days of this country, you know, where you'd want to please your man. You want to keep a tidy house.
Well, you got it. You know, in fact, my husband is real into role playing, and he had me dress up like Marilyn Monroe because he heard I did such a good impression. And I did the sexiest rendition of Happy Birthday. Do you want to hear it?
Yeah. You didn't do that move where you stood on the box fan.
Oh, no, instead of wearing the terry cloth robe, I switched to polar fleece.
Oh, that is hot.
And I did this, and he said he had got his motor running. This was his big birthday present. I was practicing all year. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Mr. President. Happy birthday to you.
Wow. Yeah.
Sultry.
Your husband's a lucky man.
Oh, thanks.
All right. Let me hit Lightstream real quick. How much interest are you paying on your credit cards? You paying every month? Is it too much? Consolidate your credit cards into one payment at a lower fixed rate and start saving money. It's easy with a credit card consolidation. Oh. Credit card consolidation loan from Lightstream. Rates start at just 5.95 APR with auto pay and excellent credit. Get a loan from $5,000 to $100,000 with absolutely no fees. You can even get your money as soon as the day you apply. Apply now. Get a special interest rate discount and save even more. The only way to get this discount is to go to lightstream.com/Adam. That is lightstream.com/Adam. Right, Dawson?
Subject to credit approval. Rates range from 5.95% APR to 19.99% APR and include 0.5% auto pay discount. Lowest rate requires excellent credit. Terms and conditions apply and offers are subject to change without notice. Visit lightstream.com/Adam for more information.
All right, what else you got, Gina Grand?
Well, let's move on to the Super Bowl since that's coming up. So we are going to go over some of the things that Brian loves, the prop bets.
Oh, let's hear it.
Of course, we always do the coin toss and the liquid, you know, the color of the Gatorade, which, by the way, orange is the favorite at +125. But you can also put money down on wagers involving the number of commercials with a dog. The over-under on that is 4.5. Mm. The first coach to show his nostrils, which I guess is a comment on the masks and the keyboard. Yeah, or the keyboard, the clipboard. And the number of times we'll see Tom Brady's wife, Gisele Bündchen, on screen. That, the over-under, is 1.5.
Mm. Well, I guess if you're going to do a thing, if you're going to bet Gisele Bündchen, you should also bet Brady scoring touchdowns or whatever, because it would a reason that if every time he scored a touchdown, they would cut up whatever. So you should be consistent, or you should hedge your bet and cover yourself by going with Gisele and go low on the touchdown prop bet with Brady. But either way, I don't know. The prop bet is an interesting thing because it's so tantalizing for so many people, but I never really think about it. It feels so arbitrary to me. Like, it doesn't feel like there's any, I guess it's sort of, I don't know. Is it the difference between playing blackjack and playing slot machines? Some people love playing slot machines, and I don't like playing slot machines. I like to feel like I'm involved. Like it's not going to work, but I'm in this mix somehow.
Or like video poker.
Yeah.
You know, well, like, are you sitting at the table, or are you playing by yourself?
No, it's not. It's not so much that. It's that one is completely random, and the other, okay. And not all the prop bets are completely random. But I'm saying slot machine is random.
Playing
21. If you're looking at what the dealer's showing, and he's showing a three, so you
Yeah.
You know, Brian.
I will say, as an enthusiast of prop bets, it's my favorite part of the Super Bowl. I generally don't even bet on the spread or the outcome. I do prop bets almost exclusively. And I'll also say, I'm not very good at it, so don't take my advice as gospel. However, you're right 100% about the prop bets that get a lot of attention. The coin toss, the what color will so-and-so's hair be at halftime show. You know what I mean? Like that stuff is arbitrary, and I have no time for that. I never bet on the coin toss, I never bet on the Gatorade or whatever. The stuff that actually is interesting is, and this is boring to Gina and to 98% of the population, but like how many field goals will there be? And then you start to do some strategy like, okay, what's the game going to be like? How many punts are there going to be? How many sacks are there going to be? Like, will Brady throw more than 0.5 interceptions? You know, things like that. That's where you're like, okay, how's this game going to go? And you really think about it, and then it pays off if you're right.
Yeah.
That's the fun. Yeah. Those are my favorite prop bets.
I think he throws more than half an interception. That's
absolutely
me. Also, yeah, when you start getting into who's going to score first for the Chiefs, then that's gets more nuanced, because that's when Cousin Sal comes in. You start thinking, you start looking at numbers about Tyreek Hill or Kelsey or whoever. And you start that, then it does become that. So some of the prop bets do involve strategy. What else, Gina Grad?
Well, if you're watching the Super Bowl, you're definitely going to be home, because California has said that we can't watch TV at a restaurant. And a lot of that has to do with the Super Bowl. So last Friday, they decided that, yes, we can do dining, we can do outdoor dining, but the TV screens at bars and restaurants have to be turned off. That's in an effort to keep restaurants from becoming overcrowded for sporting events. Also, no more and people screaming and shouting and spitting. No more than 6 people can be seated per table. All must be from the same household, 8 feet apart, and the TVs are off. So sports bars for Super Bowl are not going to add up here.
Does it? Sorry to interrupt. Does it say specifically, is the language TVs must be off? Because a bar could very easily, cleverly get around this by projecting. You know,
that's
what I mean?
True. And I'm sorry, I said state, I meant county. And yes, the television screens to be turned off.
Well, they should just fucking
turn
them
on. Do with that what you will.
Fuck all those guys. Just turn it on, everybody. This'll mark the beginning of the rebellion. Just fucking turn them on. Jesus Christ.
No,
go ahead.
Okay. We do have a couple of spots that have been, I don't think they've been leaked. They've been released for the Super Bowl.
This is the big thing now. Yeah.
This is the big thing. I picked two that I thought would be of interest. The first one is Mike Myers and Dana Carvey doing a Wayne's World reunion for Uber Eats. But unless you're watching closely, you won't know it's for Uber Eats. Here's the ad.
All right.
Hey, we're back. 2020, man, that was a great year.
Not.
Yeah, it really sucked.
It sucked donkey.
Good one. We just wanted to say that we'll see you soon for the game, which for legal reasons cannot be named.
We'll see you on the big bowl.
The gigantic bowl.
Totally legal.
Yeah, completely legal.
All right, good teaser.
Yeah, I feel good about it.
Yeah, I saw this one somewhere. Yes.
Is this a Super Bowl ad? Will this air during the game? Because if they airtime, they should be able to say Super Bowl.
Well, this is saying already appearing online ahead of the game. And I think that's probably just a fun
thing
for them to do.
I don't know if I like the pre-showing of the Super Bowl spot, because I feel like the definition of a Super Bowl spot is the Super Bowl spot.
Yep.
If you re-aired, like, let's just say, there's commercials we're all familiar with, a McDonald's commercial or a Ford commercial or something. If you aired that during the Super Bowl, to me, it's not a Super Bowl spot. I want my own bespoke creation, and I want it unveiled on the Super Bowl. So
that's what makes it fun.
And Mike Myers is starting to look bizarre at this point.
Well, they're trying to make him look maybe a little younger for the joke.
I get it, but I saw this before this, and there's something going on with Mike.
This is the perfect time to mention this because I've been getting a lot of tweets about this. Yes, there will be hashtag sportsball this year. Please send me from verified accounts only. I'm not trying to dox anybody. Send me your best sportsball tweets. Adam, you're familiar with the idea.
Sure.
This is, of course, the people who are like, "Durr, is there a game today?" And these are the nerds that are like, "I love pop culture. I'm a pop culture nerd." And yet they somehow don't have time for the biggest pop culture event of the year. Fuck yourselves.
Send me
the tweets. We'll name the winner of sports ball and make a generous donation to a charity in their name.
By the way, on tomorrow's show, Michael Cohen and Pitbull. A lot
together
of range
again
there.
At last.
Wow.
Yeah.
That is phenomenal.
We got
go
the Super
August.
Bowl picks.
Yeah. All right, let's do one more, Gina Grand.
Oh, right. Well, the other commercial is Doritos 3D, and Jimmy Kimmel makes a nice little cameo in that one. Mm. So I'll show you too. But let me set it up since a lot of it's visual. It's basically a flat, two-dimensional, very, very jarring, because you know how commercials love to do that, flat Matthew McConaughey that walks like a two-dimensional figure until he has a Dorito 3D, and this is that commercial.
Lately, I haven't been feeling quite like myself. Life used to feel fuller.
I want to
Matthew?
Break free.
Matthew?
Some days are harder than others.
I want to break free.
No.
Getting sucked up
it's
by
like
the Roomba.
I used to be on solid ground.
Blows away.
Please welcome Matthew McConaughey.
Did you drive here, or did you travel by fax?
I want to break free.
There's got to be a way to get back.
I want to break free. This time I know it's for real. I'm falling in love. God knows.
Now he's puffing up God regular size.
Yeah.
Slams his head against the vending machine.
Doritos, now in 3D.
Well.
This, is McConaughey bordering losing a little street cred? I know he does the Lincoln stuff and he would do the Jim Beam or Old Crow,
Wild Turkey.
But that was kind of on brand for him.
Yeah.
Like, I kind of felt like that was on brand. This doesn't feel on brand for him.
He goes back and forth for me. Like, he'll come out with, like, you know, He'll do some sweet movies early in his career. Then he'll do those ridiculous Kate Hudson, romantic comedies. You're like, oh, fuck Matthew McConaughey. Then he'll do like Dallas Buyers Club and Wolf of Wall Street. Like,
right.
He's back.
Right.
Then he'll do shit like this. And you're like, I don't know what to make of this guy.
Yeah.
Please don't forget Tippy Toes.
Oh, that's yes.
Right. With Gary Oldman.
Gary and Kate Beckinsale.
Oh,
that
yeah.
movie must never be forgotten, as much as he might try to get us to forget it.
Is that movie findable?
Let me find
the trailer is.
Yeah. And you may want to forget Surfer Dude along the way.
Yeah, he's all over the place. He has legit great credits and then some that are just abysmal.
Yeah. All right, let's bring it home, Gina Grad.
You got it. I'm Gina Grad, and that's the news.
Gina Grad.
That was the news with Gina Grad.
Oh, last but not least, there's Geico. Do you own your home? Do you rent your home? Well, you do one or the other, I'm sure. And you got your auto policy, and now Geico makes it easy to bundle. Take your homeowner's or your renter's insurance, and you bundle it up. You go to geico.com, you get a quote, see just how much you could save. When you bundle with Geico, visit geico.com today. That is geico.com. All right, Pitbull and Michael Cohen.
Yeah.
Tomorrow. I got to say, I enjoyed talking to Brett Favre as well. I thought that guy
cool.
was a pretty interesting cat. And I want to thank Gerry Callahan and Eric Bolling as well. And until next time, it's Adam for Gerry and Eric and Brett and Gina and Bald saying mahalo.